The All Souls Witchy Women Podcast, Episode 14, Secrets in the All Souls Trilogy. Welcome to All Souls Witchy Women, a fan and definitely not official podcast where we talk all things All Souls. We are three women who met over Outlander and then jumped into the All Souls world like the time-traveling witches we wish we were. You can't go more than about 25 pages in the All Souls Trilogy without someone tripping over a secret, either one they kept or one they discovered, or one they're being forced to maintain. The whole process of looking for Ashmole 782 is about trying to uncover the secrets that it holds for demons, witches, and vampires. It never goes well, or usually never. So we're going to look at secrets and the trouble they cause in the All Souls Trilogy. And to look into those secrets, my fellow witchy women, Janet.
Hello.
And Ashley.
I can keep anything in the vault.
Oh, so the three of us are going to talk about secrets. But before we jump into the All Souls Trilogy, we need to have an Outlander moment. There's a pivotal moment in the first book of Outlander where Jamie and Frasier have a show.
Oh, this podcast is going to go well. It is. I can just tell.
Some people do wish there were two of him, so it's okay.
God. Words.
Okay.
Okay. There is a pivotal moment in Outlander where Jamie and Claire have to decide how they're going to manage the secrets that they both have in their lives. I'm just going to use the words from the book to talk about this scene. So Jamie says to Claire, "There are things that I cannot tell you, at least not yet, and I'll ask nothing of you that you cannot give me. But what I would ask of you, when you do tell me something, let it be the truth, and I'll promise you the same. We have nothing now between us save respect, perhaps. And I think that respect has maybe room for secrets, but not for lies. Do you agree?" And Claire says, "Yes, I agree. I'll give you honesty."
And then that lasts for like how long before they just step right over that. But yes. God, I do love that line, that passage.
I know. I love it.
But what do you think about that, though? I mean, is there room for secrets but not for lies? I don't know. It's tricky, as our discussion will show.
I think so. That's me. Here's my two cents. I feel like, is there, like, qualifying factors? Like, does the secret put, you know, does it affect the other person that you're keeping it from? Is there anything to be harmed about them? Does it have anything to do with them? I feel like there are certain things, and maybe I'm just thinking of, like, you know, having partner or spouse, and like things that we keep safe for friends that don't necessarily have to involve partner input or knowledge, or vice versa. And it's something that doesn't cross or intersect their paths or could put them in harm's way or something to that effect. So I don't know. I kind of think there are some occasions in which there is room for this to be accurate.
I've had a devil of a time thinking about this podcast because I think about the secrets, both what I would categorize secrets in my own life and secrets from the book. I keep coming back to, a secret is just a truth that hasn't been told yet. Because sometimes you intentionally keep a secret, but sometimes you have something that's buried deep inside of you, and it's not ready to come out yet. It's not appropriate for it to come out, or maybe it'll never come out at all. But it's not, you know, it's more about you. It's not the other people so much. And, you know, some of the things that we're going to talk about that are secrets between Matthew and Diana, most of these are in the first book. They're just things that haven't come out yet that maybe, I mean, we know them as book readers, so we know that they're secrets, but they just haven't evolved in their relationship enough. And, you know, as you're in a relationship, you tell stories over time, right? You get to know each other and things gradually come out. Matthew probably wouldn't lead off on a date that he's 1500 years old. You got to ease into that shit, you know? So it's a secret, but
Or that he killed somebody he loved. Like, oops, dang.
Right. Yeah, blood rage. Like, that's like fifth right. date material, right?
Yeah,
not right. the beginning. Right. I like that, by the way. I like the idea that that you've just described, that secrets are just, they can still be a little doughy on the inside. They're not quite baked and ready to come out of the oven yet. They're just doughy, and they could cause harm. You don't want any, like, you know, you don't want any raw eggs digesting in the cookies.
Right.
They're just yes. doughy
secret
inside.
Salmonella.
Yes.
No, I think that's good, and I hadn't thought of it that way before. And I definitely, you know, I'm going to put that over in my sort of remember that. should a secret ever come out unintentionally on my part, I can then say, oh, well, it just wasn't appropriate yet.
And see, that makes me question basically my whole life in saying that. But
I mean, I think one of the challenges of secrets is that it, as with other behaviors, it can become habit forming. It can become a crutch, I think.
Sure.
And I think when that happens, you know, it's the likelihood of it becoming potentially damaging increases.
Right. Yeah. Agreed. Now that we still don't know what a secret is.
Not a clue.
Right. Right. Other than it's possible I've kept a few.
I've definitely kept a few, and I'm not sure whether they're like, are they secrets? Or are they, I know we were talking about, like, are they lies of omission? I'm like, or are they just an omission of information? It's not a lie. It's not a truth. It's just, to Nikki's point, it just hasn't been shared yet. It wasn't meant, you know, it's not saying it wouldn't come out. But now, yes, now I'm going to question right. it all.
Well, so. I think one of the challenges about secrets is that the person who's keeping it may have all the best intentions, right? But then inadvertently or whatever, the person they're keeping the secret from discovers it, and there's just no way for that person not to react negatively. You know, in other words, right. it's hard for that person to sort of say, oh, I get it. You were just trying to protect my feelings, because it just doesn't feel that way.
Right.
Typically, you know, if I were talking about this hypothetically. Yeah,
of course, hypothetically.
Right. So
hypothetically, and not in all in a super applicable way as found in this book series.
Yeah, right. Or in my life ever. Right. No, I know. And I think that's, you know, because then it just starts to become lame. Well, I was going to tell you, but it wasn't baked yet. I don't know. Maybe it's because I'm married to an attorney who is a professional arguer. You know,
well,
yeah, it's hard to pull anything over. And once it's out, it just generally never goes well.
That would be obnoxious.
It's true. I've learned to be a better arguer as a result, but yeah. Is that a skill I needed? I don't know.
I can't think of a better pairing right now for this conversation as a lawyer and a professional wordsmither like yourself, like a journalist in the art of putting words together. I just subscribe. I went in on the couch. I want to watch all the moments take place.
Yeah.
Right?
Right.
So the next time you're having an argument, can you just FaceTime us?
Okay. Yeah, sure. That'll
just,
yeah.
Just set the phone on the table. Mm-hmm. He doesn't have to know.
Right. Mm-hmm. That's good. I'll remember that. If nothing else, it will be entertaining.
Except when Nikki and I forget we're supposed to be on mute and we're like crunching cocktail ice and like, oh, good point. Good point. Oh, good. Objection.
Right. 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 Yeah. Anyway, I feel fairly confident that he could parse this whole secret thing down to a way and a place where, it would never go well for me. Just saying, because, you know, he can figure that out. Anyway.
Well, so we have, for the purposes of this podcast, there are so many freaking secrets.
Yes.
In these books. They're just everywhere. That if we wanted to talk about all of them, this would be like a 15-part series, and ain't nobody got time for that. So.
Yeah.
We have picked some of our, not favorite, but some of the secrets that really stand out in the books to talk about.
Yeah.
And, I mean, so it seems appropriate maybe to start with the biggest secret of them all. And that's the secret that Stephen and Rebecca kept from, well, everybody.
Everybody.
Yeah.
And see, this is one of the problems with secrets, right? If it dies with you, then like maybe that wasn't your intent, right?
Right.
And so therefore it can really, you know, in other words, you may have had good intentions with how you were creating it. And at the, you had visions in your mind about when you were going to reveal said secret, the appropriate moment. And then, you know, something happens, like you get killed by a bunch of witches.
I don't want to jump ahead, but then there's like a whole piece of, but if someone else knew the secret, it feels like there's like a transfer of ownership that's still then, like, even if it's out of your control on when it, maybe you were intending to reveal it, then it puts that onus on the next person holding on to it. Like, am I supposed to now honor their wishes? Oh my God, should she know this? I'm not going to jump ahead, but I just, as you said that, I'm like, yeah, if you die, but if you've at least made one other person privy to it, mm-hmm. then there's, that's a whole other piece to it.
Right, right. And it gets into that not your story to tell kind of thing.
Yeah.
Which is a big theme, happens to be one of my favorite parts of the book, that thought that thought process. But anyway.
Right.
Let's do the reveal on the Stephen and Rebecca.
Yeah, so Stephen and Rebecca didn't tell Diana that she was a weaver, that she was the powerful witch, that they suspected that her powers were greater than anything they had known or seen. And this impacted Diana. And then basically everybody around her through her whole life until the book starts. I think she's always known there was something up, but she certainly didn't know she had the powers that she finds out later that she has.
Right. And it certainly affected sort of her relationship with her aunts. And because, you know, Sarah didn't know anything about it. And so she's trying to be a good caretaker for Diana, but Diana's not interested in witchcraft, so therefore she doesn't do certain things with her as a result. And then, obviously, Emily knew something. Was it Emily actually knew, or did she just suspect it? She knew.
I feel like it's treated two different ways. I feel like in the show, Emily knew more.
Yeah, right.
Than in the book. I feel like in the book, she suspected.
Right.
But in the show, it kind of made you think that she knew. Because then that led to the showdown with Sarah then, who felt betrayed.
Right.
Because Emily knew, but never told her.
Right, right.
And, you know, it just, it's just like ripples in a pond. You think you've just thrown a little stone in the water, but, you know, it has this ripple effect and it reaches everybody surrounding Diana.
Right, yeah. I think the other part of secrets is sort of who's doing the secrets. I mean, on some levels, part of the thing that was so sort of extraordinary about this was that it was parents doing it to their child, mm-hmm. right? And so they're doing it, you know, for the best of intentions. They're concerned. They know that Peter Knox is sort of sniffing around and trying to figure out if Diana has superpowers and they've got powers that other people are jealous about and, you know, skeptical about and sort of concerned about. But I do feel, and to me, and maybe this speaks more to my own, you know, personal life, but I feel like the fact that parents have an extra obligation not to do that kind of stuff.
Yes. I was kind of going through this process this week as I was thinking about this podcast. This past week, and I was thinking, because this is a subject near and dear to my heart, but I was thinking about adoption and the way that in olden times people would adopt a child and then it was this big secret. Mm-hmm. In some families it was this big secret.
Right, right.
And so like everybody who was older than the kid knew they were adopted.
Yeah.
And so, and then at some point in this child's life, maybe when they're 20, maybe when they're 50, somebody goes, oh yeah, you're adopted. And then it just completely changes this person's life. And there's a sense of betrayal that goes with that because these people knew the secret about you.
Right.
And had been looking at you differently all of your life because they knew the secret about you. And you never had a clue. I don't know why that is so tied in my mind with these secrets, but I think it's just the secrets that you keep from a child and you do it as a parent to try to protect your child, but you wind up really effing them up in the long run.
So how old was Diana when she was spellbound? Like, to me, I don't remember from the book, you know, if there was an...
Oh, God, is this a pop quiz?
No, wait, I don't remember the exact age if it's said in the book, but when I look at her in the show,
yeah,
she was like, what, maybe 7?
Yeah, I was going to say 8.
Seven is the number that
yeah
was in my head.
So, given that, I mean, could they have told her and made it into sort of a game? And in other words, you know, I'm just asking this as sort of an abstract question of whether or not that would have been another way to do it, in which case the secret would have been the family secret rather than the secret that of which holds Diana back from actually understanding herself, you know, for decades, actually, you know. Whereas, you know, but I understand the concern from a parent's part of like, but will the child actually be able to shut up, you know, and not say something? Right. And, you know, I mean, I think that's a risk. But that might have been another way to do the secret in a way that was more inclusive and potentially less damaging. You know, we all know family secrets that don't go well. So, you know, I think we can take a moment and say, yep, I can name one. Or 7. Anyway, but I wonder, you know, that might have been another way to handle it where it would have been a little less damaging. Anyway.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Yeah, you do have me wondering if there was some big plan to, like, let's just give it a few years till all the, maybe the intense microscope that we're under fades a little. I have a feeling it would have never faded, which has me wondering if there was ever a plan to reveal it to her.
Right.
And then I'm like, to your point, like, let's let you in on it. It's like, what a great time to tell a kid that you've manipulated sort of who they are and what they're doing during the teen years. Let's definitely roll that out during the teen years. Those aren't tumultuous at all. Then tell them to keep quiet about these amazing powers we've prevented you from having. So when I play all that out, I'm like, they were never going to tell her until she was like,
yeah, no, 30, I think that's right.
Which is now. So here we are.
Yeah.
But I mean, maybe not. Can't really say in a hypothetical scenario. And I'm sure as the rest of us all parent on the fly, right? You wish that there is a formula or a manual or anything to get you through it. And really you just go with what feels right on instinct. And as that instinct either changes or evolves or the picture changes shape, you make different choices to adapt to that new vision. And so who's to say when they would have revealed this or not, because they don't get to tell us. They're not here to tell us.
Yeah, I mean, and it's, you know, look, it's a better story this way, so.
Sure. But man, did it muck her up.
Yes.
I'm just thinking, if my parents had come to me when I was like 15 and said, look, you've got some powers.
Yeah, they'd be off.
You can't tell anybody, but you've got some powers. I think I would have set fire to everything.
Exactly. I was about to say, I actually picture your 15-year-old coming to you and being like, hey, Mom, just so we're clear, I do have powers. Like,
right.
Yeah, well, we already know that.
Yeah, right. I know. That's what I'm saying. Like, it's the reverse scenario. But yeah, like, what 15-year-old wouldn't just be like, I'm going to try it out on everything. It's going to be awesome.
Yeah, right. Yes. Yeah. Well, maybe that's not the age that you would reveal it.
I think that's fair.
Yeah. Anyway, it you know, as with you said before, with your lovely ripple, you know, metaphor, I mean, it ripples out. And so, of course, it affects Emily. And, you know, it affects Sarah when she discovers that, you know, her sister didn't trust her enough with the secret.
Mm-hmm. And, you know, if we're going to talk about that for a little second, I have to, for a second. Jesus Christ, I cannot talk tonight. I'm really sorry.
I think you're doing a fantastic job.
That moment in the show, or it was a series of moments in the show when the secret came out and Sarah and Emily sort of had their reckoning. Those were some of the most beautiful scenes in the show.
Yeah.
And I think it ultimately drew them closer because the secret was out. Everybody knew. Nobody had to hold things back anymore. And so I think it did draw everybody closer eventually. But man, what a way to get there.
Yeah, and it could have just as easily not gone that way.
Right.
You know? Yeah.
Now, you just said that, and I'm thinking, like, the weight of carrying around a secret that large has to feel as debilitating as actually being spellbound. Like, you think that you're you know what I mean? Like, you're not the one who's been physically altered in some way to kind of contain you and restrain your power. And yet the weight of holding on to something like that, you might as well have like a 1,000-pound blanket on.
Yep.
I think that's a really good way of describing it, that a secret is like being spellbound. Go Ashley.
Thanks, guys. One a show.
Well, and when you sing, then we'll have two moments. So anyway.
I'm waiting for that.
Right.
Those were my favorite scenes as well. Just, I want to state that for the record while you're on it, because I'll sing the praises of any moment that we can bring that up. That moment with them on the couch.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
So well done.
Ooh, yeah. Every time.
Yeah. So well done. So then we have Diana.
Diana.
Who has her own secrets, even though she's, you know, the focus of a big secret, she still manages to keep her own.
She confuses me because she's got secrets from herself.
Yes.
How do you tell yourself secrets? But she does. I mean, she lies to herself, whatever it is that she needs to do to not fully recognize what is going on.
Right. Okay. So I guess the point of that is that it's sort of, that's the other, you know, that's another way in which secrets can be negative, right? In that they sort of, they force you to act in ways that you are lying to yourself. I mean, this is one of my problems with secrets, is that it's the line between a secret and a lie is so close.
Right.
Because when you're keeping a secret and somebody asks you about it, you have to not tell the truth when you keep the secret, right? So, and I, you know, lying is one of my buttons. You know, I used to say to my kids before I was about to ream them out about something, I'd be like, I'm going to ask you this question once, and don't add lying to where we are in this chat, because that's not going to go well.
I always tell my girl, when I ask you a question, you need to answer honestly and truthfully, because the odds are I already know the answer.
Oh yeah. That's good. Be omniscient. It's good that it's good that she thinks you're omniscient. Yeah.
Yeah. I think she knows the truth, but
well,
I keep going with that. But so I was thinking about something, you know, I do a lot of HR work in my regular job, and I have a lot of secrets. It would be unlawful for me to talk about many of the things I know. So I keep the secrets because they protect people.
Mm-hmm.
And I was thinking about this also in the context of, you know, what Ashley was saying about secrets, how they, you know, they weigh you down. And I was thinking, my work secrets, they don't weigh me down because they aren't personal.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, I can look at these people and go, okay, yeah, I know this thing and this thing and this thing that I can never talk about, and that's cool. And then I can just go on with my day. If that was my family, I think it would weigh me down a lot. So I think somewhere in this mix, the impact that secrets have on people is determined by how close you are to them, or how close they are to you, and what other kind of feelings there are. Because if you know a secret about somebody, but you also aren't emotionally invested in them, it's not that big of a deal, really.
Right. Yeah.
You know?
Well, and I think that's a good point. There are times when secrets are good. You are being professional in your example there. Diana won't tell Satu what she knows, right? You know, and she will not let Satu inside to learn what she does know. So there are times when that sort of protection is a good move. Yeah.
And actually, these books have helped me a lot in my work, because when people come up and ask, is so-and-so pregnant?
Mm.
I can just say, that's not my tale to tell.
I know. It's like the greatest sentence ever. I'm serious. When I first read it, I was like, that's amazing. And I'm going to use...
I mean, you know, and it's the kind of things where, you know, a person is 6 months pregnant. They're clearly, you know, something is clearly going on here, but they haven't told for whatever reason, because that is someone's story to tell, right?
Yeah.
And they just look at me like, why don't you just say it? And I'm like, because it's not my tale to tell.
Yeah.
When it's when it's time to be told, it will be told.
Yeah. No, it's true. It's I have used it in real life. So,
y'all are just taking me on a magical Mr. Toad's wild ride right now, because I'm still reeling from, like, Janet, right when you said that you're having issues because the line between lie and secret is so thin, was in the exact moment where I was like, wait, was I about to give thoughts about a lie? Is this podcast about lies or secrets? God, I've gotten the theme mixed up already. We got to that and we clarified that, and it is super murky. And now I find myself cataloging all the HR secrets that I have in my head and making sure that I'm not, like, keeping anyone in some sort of compromising situation. Yeah, now you've got my brain in that direction. But I have also used the that's not my story to tell, because I'm in the business, in that day job of telling other people's stories. And it's like, that one's not mine to tell. That's not mine to tell. I haven't been professionally bound or contracted to tell that story in a public setting. That's not for you to know.
Yes. Thank you, Deborah Harkness.
Yes.
I mean, for many things, but specifically
for that. She understands your plight. She's in academia too. It came from a place of commonality for you.
Should we have a break?
Wait, can I just say one last thing about Diana?
No.
I don't yet. Yeah.
But thank you for asking.
Yeah, right. Okay, so go ahead, do the break. No.
No, say the Diana thing.
No, well, her mother, when she's sort of having these recollections, et cetera, her mother says to her, "You are my greatest secret." Mm. And, you know, that's a lovely thought, and it sort of gives you an understanding of where Rebecca was coming from in all of her actions around this. So it's just couched in the secret theme, but I thought that was lovely.
It is so lovely and touching. And think about when you think about your children, how much pride you have, and how, you know, you want to tell people the things that they've done. And for her to know that she had given birth to this magical being. Right?
Yep.
And she couldn't share it with anybody, because if she had, it would have meant the death of her child.
Right. Mm. Right.
I find that line so bittersweet, because as mothers, we just want to bore people to death with stories about how great our kids are, and she just couldn't.
Yeah. Right. Right.
In a way that Diana could probably never understand until she has the babies of her own with special powers, you know?
Right, right.
Because you said we were allowed to talk about all three, right? I can't remember. Are you going to have to edit me?
Oh, I think everything is fair game.
Fair game, people. Yeah. You've had a lot of time to catch up. I mean, if the show didn't suck you in to read all three books, there's just no hope for you.
Yeah.
But please do keep listening.
Yeah, really. Yes. Exactly.
But maybe also have a wine break with us.
Ooh, yes.
Maybe.
Before we get into the mother of all secret covers, or the keepers, or the lover of all secret keepers, because I think you all know where we're headed next. Matthew. All these secrets, I think we should definitely break for wine, because we're going to need it to keep sledging through. So I talked to Bayard, and keeping on theme with this episode, here's what he's about to give us. I don't think you're ready. So he's agreed to lift the veil on the winemaking world and share with us a few secrets of the business.
Wow.
Like, maybe
that's so cool.
I know. He was like, you know, there's some tricks of the trade. There's some things that get added here and there that you're not aware of, and some other stuff I could share. And I'm like, well, now you've got me wondering if I want you to share, or if I wish they'd just stayed hidden. But I'll let you decide for yourselves once you hear what he has to say.
Well, which is of course true with all secrets. Right?
Correct.
Yes, so.
Ooh.
Mm.
Put them back in the wine cave.
Take it away, Bayard.
Hey, everybody. This is Bayard. I'm here with your wine note of the week. Well, this week we are talking about secrets of the wine industry. That's right. Some of the little known stuff that goes on behind closed doors that us as consumers may not be aware of. The first thing isn't necessarily a secret, it is a federal law. So when you go and you pick up a bottle of Chardonnay or Cabernet or Merlot, by law, the winemaker is only required to put 75% of that grape in the bottle. Sometimes they use 100% and it is 100% varietally pure. However, they blend in a few other things, usually, in order to create a certain taste profile. So in some red wines, you may have other red wines blended in. So if you were to pick up a bottle of Cabernet, it could be 100% Cabernet Sauvignon. However, usually it is blended in with other grapes. So you'll have a bottle of Cabernet, but it will also have a little bit of Merlot and maybe a little bit of Malbec blended in as well to create a certain flavor profile. Same goes for white wines. You could have some Chardonnay or some Sauvignon Blanc that may have a touch of Viognier blended in or Chenin Blanc in order to create a certain flavor profile. The next two are arguably the most disturbing. So in keeping along the lines of creating a certain flavor profile, especially in red wines, you want to be able to have some oak aging. You want to be able to have that wine rest in barrel for a certain amount of time. Well, that's expensive. Barrels are expensive. So what do winemakers do in order to cut corners? They will sometimes put in extracts that taste like wood, or they will put in a very, very fine wood dust that dissolves in the wine that makes it taste as though it's rested in barrel. The third technique is steeping chips. So just like you would steep a tea bag in hot water, they will take a lot of oak chips and literally steep them in red wine for many weeks at a time. As that infuses into the wine, it makes it taste as though it has been put in a barrel. These are some of the corners that the wine industry will cut in order to sell more wine, get wine to market quicker, and make more profit. The last piece is called Mega Purple. And Mega Purple is a concentrate that is used in a lot of mass-produced wines. It is high in sugar, high in alcohol, and when you blend it in with actual grapes that have come right out of the vineyard, it gives a certain flavor profile that can be very, very attractive. It also helps winemakers to take, let's take an average of, say, a gallon of wine and stretch that out to be maybe a gallon and a half or 2 gallons by adding concentrate to it. Yes, you're watering it down, but you're creating a certain flavor profile by adding this concentrate to the natural wine in order to get that certain flavor profile that you're going for. All that said, there's a sea of really, really good wine out there. Don't let any of what I've said deter you from going out and trying new wines and new labels and just enjoying wine all around. Cheers.
I don't know why I started laughing.
Because you're not sure if you'd wished he'd kept them hidden, or you're happy that he shared. Happy or hidden.
I am so happy that Bayard shared secrets with us. Wine secrets, because maybe those are the best secrets.
True.
Maybe. So now that we're a little lubricated with the wine...
Sorry, in my head I'm all like, a spoonful of wine makes the secrets go down.
Yes!
Since you let us in there.
There you go.
Could we do like a recording of you singing just all the songs that you have done on podcasts?
What a beautiful compilation. Yes. Who wouldn't want that?
Mm-hmm.
You remember all those like album compilation commercials we saw in like the 80s?
Yes, right, exactly. It would be Ashley's compilation.
Let's put a pin in that.
Yeah, that's fair. Let's... How will anyone go on until it's produced?
We got to talk about some heavy stuff here.
Mm. Yes.
Matthew. Because Matthew is a treasure trove of secrets, most of them unpleasant.
I mean,
wait, okay, here's a good question. Does Matthew have any good secrets? Something that you learned and you were like, oh, that's so sweet.
Well, I mean, I guess the fact that he's with the Knights of Lazarus and, you know, I mean,
okay,
is, you know, that's generally a good organization. They've been helping the downtrodden, et cetera, et cetera. And he doesn't spread the word about it.
I like that.
You know, on the other hand, did he need to keep it a secret from his wife or his soon to be wife? I'm not sure. But at any rate, but it's generally a positive.
I like that. He's like a Salvation Army ninja.
Yeah, I was going to say a spy, but your Salvation Army ninja is better. Better
sounds
as
like such
usual.
A do-gooder. Such a do-gooder.
Yeah.
Matthew has a lot of secrets, most of them bad. As we mentioned before, he has a bad habit of killing people, killing women specifically that he's in love with. Never a good look on a man.
No.
I've watched a lot of Law & Order SVU that has told me that is correct. That is correct sentiment.
Right.
And
right.
Just general common sense. Don't kill your lovers.
No, just don't. He has blood rage. See first bullet point, which is why he keeps killing the women he's in love with, or one reason.
I have a question, though. All right. So just based on like sheer numbers. So Diana's got a few. Rebecca and Stephen had a few. But they're mortal creatures. and they have a finite time to their lifespan. And Matthew has a lot of years on the other ones that we're evaluating. Oh, yeah. So I just feel like by sheer numbers, of course he's got a lot more secrets and some more things in the vault because he has more years of keeping them or hiding them or having them, you know, be his stories to tell that you probably lose track of where you should tell them and when. I mean, 1,500 years is a long damn time, you know, compared to her 30-something of trying of keeping them. And so I don't know. I just am like, based on numbers alone, like, is he any better or worse than anyone? Or is it just that he's been around a lot damn longer to have a lot more in the vault?
I think that's fair. I think that's a good point. I also think, or I'm going to raise the question of, is it also because he's a vampire and the whole sort of, you know, loyalty and family clan mentality is, and you know, just by dint of how they've had to live, like every so many years, he has to basically, quote, disappear, go someplace else, you know, adopt the persona of somebody who's recently, you know, snuffed it. Right. I mean, you know, so you're immediately always, everything you do is a secret, you know, based on your persona is a secret.
You're right.
So I think it goes to what you're saying, Ashley, but I also think it's just by dint of how they operate that it has to build more secretive behavior.
No joke. Can we get someone from the FBI or the CIA as a special guest on this? Because I feel like it must be a comparable type situation that you're describing of like, it's not that I don't want to say, I just can't say anything. I've been conditioned
right
in a setting where that is not a favorable thing to do. It's dangerous for everyone.
Yeah, right. And you know, and he's also in his defense in terms of how and when he shares his secrets with Diana, which, you know, leaves something to be desired, I think. But part of it is, remember, he is super cautious about allowing their relationship to, you know, become deeper because he's aware. He's like, you don't do this mating thing lightly. You know, this is for an eternity, you know, whether your eternity will be shorter than mine. So, and my life is complicated. So if you're going to buy into it, we really need to be careful.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that affects his ability to sort of reveal himself to people, which is part of how his secrets are, you know, occur and are perpetuated. It's all part of the, I'm pretending to be this other person now, you know?
I feel like, you know, don't we all build up a wall when you're getting into a new relationship and you have stuff from your past that haunts you, let alone you're not sure where it belongs in this new situation and you're hesitant to even dive into it. I just feel like his is at a level that we will never be able to comprehend, you know, as we can from the words in the book. But like, again, to the 1500 years of watching people go, how you're even in the situation at 1500 years because you are a vampire. But I'm sitting here thinking, like, I don't know, it feels sort of relatable, but just on a different scale of, like, we all have a wall that we're like, I'm not sure how much I'm willing to let you behind that just yet as we're working our way into this new partnership together. His just feels ironclad in the beginning.
I was just sort of thinking about, you know, in a relationship, secrets versus truth versus lies. Like, you know, when you come home from a shopping trip, did you buy a new dress? Yes, I did. That's the truth. Is the price you paid for it a secret? Are you lying if you just don't give the price willingly? Is it okay just to keep the price of the dress to yourself until you are asked specifically how much it cost? Yes. I'm asking for a friend.
Yeah, I think yes. The journalism side of me, I can only imagine what Janet's thinking. Like, I only answer questions that were asked. That's what I tell people in the PR world. Like, here's your talking points. You only answer and only stick to this and bridge back to where you need it to be. So I'm saying if you weren't asked directly, why would you just jump to price?
Right. Yes, I bought a dress. Yeah. Period. Right.
It's also possible, speaking hypothetically, that when you buy a dress like that, maybe you pay $50 in cash and then you only charge the other $50 and then the charge is $50. So
that is pro level.
Yeah. Well,
whatever it is, it's pro level.
That,
because I don't know what it is.
Describes my adoration with Venmo right there, because it's not real money. It's just sitting there like play money. And so it doesn't count if you spend it. Yes. Like, it's just sitting there.
It's in the Monopoly bank.
It's just sitting there. I have a friend who would answer your dress question, because hypothetically speaking, if this were to happen with, did you go buy a dress and bring it home? Are you bringing home bags of clothes? And she would say, no. And that would be because she had the clothes shipped to my house and then picked them up from here so that the packages arriving on the doorstep wouldn't draw alarm.
Yeah, see? I mean, you know, we all have our areas where
right.
It's just better on a, it's a need to know basis, and I'm pretty sure you don't need to know.
Yeah. Yeah, so we've just described Matthew, basically.
Yeah, right.
With retail examples. I love it.
Yeah.
Right. Are those new shoes, Janet? No. I've had them a long time. You just haven't noticed them. That worked better when I lived part-time in Albany. But, yeah.
Oh, yeah. Right.
But Matthew has a lot of modeling from his father, who is also, I mean, they are both vying for King of Secrets, I think.
Oh, Philippe. Philippe is the puppet master.
Yeah. I mean, I love him.
Yes.
I love him. Although this thing of this keeping the secret of how Philippe dies, I think is just one of the most gut-wrenching.
Mm. So when Diana and Matthew go back in time to see Philippe, you know, Diana is really concerned about Matthew seeing his father again, because let's just assume that everybody knows how Philippe dies. And she just knew it was going to be really painful. For Matthew, obviously they couldn't, I guess they could have told Philippe how he died in the future. He sensed point that he wasn't alive in the time that they came from.
Yeah.
So he knew that he was dead in their time, but he didn't know how he died. And Diana and Matthew, they never really discussed this, but, you know, obviously they didn't tell him when he died. And I just wonder, you know, I know that was a hard secret for them to keep, but also I think about, you know, should anyone know the hour of their death? As difficult a secret as that is to keep, how horrible would it be walking around with the knowledge of when you're going to die? Because I don't, that, bleh. Bleh? Eh?
Sorry, I'm just laughing at how we're reduced now to just making sounds. Anyhow, no, I think it's.
That's all bleh. I got.
Yeah. No, I think that whole thing is just gut-wrenching. If you knew when you were going to die, who would you tell, if anybody? Right? I mean, that's right. Like the ultimate secret, because you don't want your family to be sitting there being sad and freaking out and worrying about everything, right? So you
right,
probably
just kind of looking at you with their heads cocked to one side, like, what's she thinking now?
Yeah, right. No, I know, right? So
I'm just sitting here. I don't want to know the information. And also, that's my answer to it. Like, no one should have to carry that knowledge. And if you all have it, spare it from me. If you know it about me, spare it from me. And then there's a piece of me that's like, unless it's like hyper specific in the information, like, hey, and again, I watch a lot of Law and Order. So it's like one of those where it's like, no, for sure, don't go into that movie theater. Here's what's going to happen. As opposed to like the Outlander moment where it's like, you're just going to vaguely die in a fire at some point, you know, it's like, wait, what? Right. What am I to do with that? You know? So
right.
I know there's part of me that's like, wait, if I knew that something really harmful was about to happen to Nikki and this very specific situation, I shouldn't tell Nikki to avoid that one situation.
Right.
That's hard for me to swallow, because I'm like, eek. And then if that thing actually happens, you know, like, then is the knowledge that you maybe could have spared her from harm harder to hold than it is keeping the secret? I would think yes.
I mean, just, you know, it's just the three of us, right? I give you permission to tell
Thank
me.
You. Good. Oh, God. Okay.
You don't have to carry that around. So please help me save myself.
Yeah, I mean, I get it if it's like, hey, I've got this vision that generally in a car or on a plane or something. And then it's like, no, because I don't want to alter like the spirit of adventure
right.
and going and the way that those things help us to get to people and to having moments that we wouldn't have if we just stayed like a shut-in, avoiding situations because we're worried about what that could turn into. But
oh God, I'm having a Lost flashback.
Oh, it's been God. It's been 1 week since Nikki finished watching Lost. It's still very fresh.
No, I'm just thinking about Desmond, who has visions of Charlie dying. Charlie keeps doing things and they keep saving him because Desmond's had a vision of him dying in this place, and eventually he wasn't able to save him.
Right.
What a great show.
I can't tell you how many Lost moments I have on a regular basis now, J.J. Abrams.
Yeah, I feel like I need to rewatch it.
Well, you know, 4 months out of your life.
Yeah, right.
Well, and we don't yet have a premiere date for this fine show, so you got a little time to fill.
Exactly.
Yes, there
you
go.
True story.
Anything else about Philippe?
I can't wait to see him.
I know. I'm so excited for season two.
Okay.
And to see Septours both in modern times and in what time, Janet? What time?
Oh, wait.
Are you going
Elizabethan England?
Drink.
I gambooned today, by the way. I played Viola da Gamba today in preparation. Side note.
No, I honestly, it took a second. I was not familiar with that verb you
the
use.
Turn gambooning? Oh, God.
Yes. Right. And I was like, she bamboozled what?
What was that?
She gambooned.
If you're playing the viola da gamba, you are gambooning. True story.
My God, this podcast is educational with an E rating.
Yes, really. Right.
Wow.
Yeah. Which it's a word that, you know, you know my daughter. She never lets me forget it.
I'm going to use it frequently with you now that I've heard it. I was like, she just slipped in a verb we've never heard. Nikki.
Yeah, really. Anyway,
it was so foreign to me, it didn't even register.
Yeah, right. Well, there you go. Anyway, that was a side note because we said the phrase Elizabethan England. So,
Janet, the great gambooner.
Oh, God. Anyhow,
we got one last secret to talk about, or maybe there's more, but.
Well, we're going to just talk about one because, you know, we don't want the podcast right for this chapter. Mart, she doesn't tell Diana. Here, this tea, it's just because I love you and want you to be healthy.
Doesn't it smell pretty?
And you have to make it exactly this way, and you have to drink it every day. Promise you will. I don't know. At a certain point, Diana, really, you want to be like, hello, right? Are you not at all curious about this concept? But she wasn't. And then, you know, we learn what it really was, which was basically, you know,
herbal birth control.
Right. I like that how you just described Diana. She would have made a fine cult member, the way you just described her. Like, here, no, don't question the Kool-Aid. Just have a little sip, but drink it every time like this.
Yeah. Right. And only use these flowers. Yeah.
Right. And you can pick out the flowers, right? The flowers in the garden, you see them?
Right.
You cool?
Right.
Oh, herbal birth control. That's fantastic.
This was a secret that Mart and Isabeau had shared it,
yes,
right?
Isabeau knew.
They were in cahoots.
Yeah. No, Isabeau knew.
This comes out when they're at the Bishop house, when Diana's making her tea. And then I think it's Sarah who's like, wait. What are you drinking?
Scooby ears go up.
Right. And so it's the next moment of reckoning when they all start putting all these puzzle pieces together and she realizes what she's been drinking. And that causes Diana and Matthew to then have a conversation about, well, if they could have children, would they want children? I don't know. Do you want children with somebody you've been dating for 33 days?
You know,
is that enough time to decide?
Yeah, right. And that would just be if they were normal people, much less a vampire and a witch, who are being chased by the congregation.
Oh my God, I'm sorry. I just had this flashback to a friend like 10, 12 years ago. She's never going to listen to this. We're not that close anymore. This is not a secret. She would have told this, just to be clear. But she was getting divorced and she started dating this guy who was also on his way. And he was much older. And he had a vasectomy scheduled for the end of the month. And she was like, do you think it's weird that I ask him not to get it? And I was like, how many dates have you been on? She was like, well, I mean like three. But I'm just curious if you feel like that's weird to tell him not to get a vasectomy. I'm just going to tell you they have an 8-year-old. So
yeah, right. So I guess they worked that through.
Yeah, but it's it's the moment where you're like, I'm not sure how to answer that. It sounds like you've got your mind made up. I'm not inserting myself into that conversation. Let me know how it goes.
Yeah. Good choice on your part.
Yeah. But
my standard response to all those is there's no right or wrong way to eat a Reese's.
Oh, it's fantastic.
So
candy logic. That's great. I also am just having a good giggle in my head, picturing like this comedic showdown recolored through the Ashley brain of her just like stir, 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 like steep, 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 mix this in here, dab it this in there, stir, stir, like just so happy. And then like, what's that in there? I'm sorry, what are you doing? Like just the awareness of the ants, like, no, hold up. Don't take a sip of that. Like, what? It's this, oh no, it's like part of our ritual Mart and I had. It's like our downtime at night. No, it's not. And it's like how trusting we can be, right? Because Diana is such an intellect, so smart. She's got some good instincts about her, some common sense here and there, but it's like, well, but she's the den mom. She was so cuddly and she took care of me and she told me to take these herbs, put them in this tea.
She made me eggs.
She made me eggs. She understood that I needed actual food.
And toast. Yeah. Right.
Ooh, now that's made me wonder, did you ever have any rituals with your family that you thought were wholesome bonding moments that you found out later as an adult were not what they seemed?
Ooh.
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 I can't think of any, but
Janet, have you enabled any of those moments with your children?
No, not that I'm recalling instantaneously, but I'm sure my family has had plenty of them, and I just was one of those unwitting participants. Yeah.
We're going to email your family to see how they would answer this question.
Yeah. Right.
Put a pin in that too. Far for chapter 2 of our secrets conversation, there'll be an Ashley singing compilation and Janet's family traditions unveiled.
Yes, right. The real story of what my children have done. Yeah, I think that's good. It'll be a bestseller.
Wow, we have plans for the future. Clearly,
yes. Can I say one last thing about? I'm not asking that question. I'm going to say one last thing about secrets, which is I don't remember who said this, but maybe Isabeau. Vampire lives are measured in secrets kept, not years.
Ooh.
I think that's a good,
that sounds like Isabeau.
I think it was Isabeau. And anyway,
so with that, do you think that Matthew is younger or older than 1500 years?
Yes, seriously. He's like 1500 secrets
old. Yeah, that's great. I'd like to measure my life in tacos, but I like that they're measuring it in secrets.
Oh, tacos. Yes.
I would be about as old as Matthew, I think, maybe in the past year.
Anyway, I thought that was a good point, so.
Yes. Maybe that's a good point to stop on. Ashley, you got anything you want to say?
Happiness lies in your own hand. It took me much too long to understand how it could be until you shared your secret with me. Something's coming over me.
Oh my God.
My baby's got a secret. Listen, I didn't say I was going to sing well. I just said I was going to sing.
At some point, we're going to have to start paying royalties. And you know what? I'm okay with that.
Oh, that would be if Madonna at some point could identify that that might have been an attempt at her song, she might charge me, but I'm fairly certain we just got off scot-free. No shame, none.
I don't think we can top that conclusion.
No, I don't think we can either. And if I could find our outro, I would read it and then we would be finished.
Sure. In the meantime, you can all ponder whether the E rating we have for our podcast just covers my singing. Just award people.
Great.
Okay, I think that's going to do it. Thanks for spending some of your valuable time with us as we discussed all things All Souls. We hope you enjoyed it as much as we did, and then if you feel inspired, you'll leave a review on Apple Podcasts. If you'd like to join in the conversation, find us on Twitter and Instagram at All Souls WW, on Facebook at All Souls Witchy Women Podcast and Blog, and online at allsoulswitchywomen.com. See you soon.